Hi everyone, Aaron here for zollotech, and today Apple released iOS 13.3 Developer Beta 2. Now this is out for developers and will soon be released to public beta testers. If it's not later today or by the time you're watching this video, it will be the following day. That's what they did last week. They released it the following day, and then you'll be able to have all the same changes. Now, as far as the size of this, you'll see this one is at 230.1 megabytes, and that was actually on my iPhone 6S Plus. Now on my iPhone 11 Pro Max, it was much larger because I was on the public version. I had switched back and you'll see it was 3.95 gigabytes. So the size will be much bigger if you're going from the public version to a beta or from a beta back to a public version. So just keep that in mind. The size will be closer to about 250 megabytes or so. Now let's take a look at the build number. The build number is 17C5038A, and that A normally signifies that we're very close to a final release, which is fairly surprising because I didn't expect this one to release that quickly, but we could see it within another couple weeks or so. Now, this particular update actually does have a modem update, at least for the iPhone 11 Pro Max. However, the issues with LTE and things, maybe they're resolved in this one. Apple did not specify in any notes as far as what was fixed, as far as that goes. So there may be the fixes that were in iOS 13.2.2. We don't know for sure, but the switching from Wi-Fi to LTE and then having your data work was working fine in the 13.2.2 public release, but I'm not sure about this one. And an easy way to check is just do what I did, was turn off the Wi-Fi, and now it says you're back online. And that's the first time I opened it. So there may or may not be an issue with this or not as far as the switching from Wi-Fi to LTE. It's really hard to say at this point. Let's go to a website and hit refresh, and now it's offline. So I don't know if they've fixed this or not, but it's obviously still a problem on this phone, and it wasn't with 13.2.2. In order to fix it, I had to do a hard reset or just reboot the phone by wiping the memory. So I'll try that in a little bit, but that's something just to note that you may still have issues with that, but there was a modem update. Now, as far as anything that's new within this update, well, there's not a whole lot new that you can actually see. There is one small change or fix, but we'll talk about that in a moment. Now, the first thing that you actually can't see is that there's some additions for .dev and .app domains. So for example, instead of .com, apple.com, it would be apple.dev. They will now default to HTTPS instead of HTTP. This is more for developers as opposed to public users. So just keep that in mind. Now, also, Safari now supports NFC, USB and Lightning FIDO 2 compliant security keys. So for example, if you use a YubiKey that supports FIDO, you can now use it in Safari if you're actually trying to log into a website that requires an authentication key that requires any of those USB or NFC or Lightning connections. So when I log into Google, for example, there's the Titan security key. It's that sort of thing. You should be able to use those now. Now, there is a fix that some people have noted, and this one was actually mentioned by Marvin Yu on Twitter, and the Beats Solo Pro, when connected before, you wouldn't get the icon when it was connected. So for example, I don't have the Beats Solo Pro, but I have the Power Beats Pro. And so when these were connected, let's see if I can get them to connect. Well, for some reason they popped up on the iPhone SE, so I can show you here, but this one has all sorts of glitches. So this could be something else they need to fix in the update. You'll see it's just glitching like crazy. So something's interesting there, but for the Beats Solo Pro, it now has the proper icon. So apparently this update is more buggy than I realized. You'll see the glitches going on, and all of these are on the same version. So that should give you an idea of some of the bugs and why you shouldn't necessarily try a beta if you're on a stable public release. Now, one of the things that they've fixed has to do with assistive touch. There were some new icons that were added. So if we go to accessibility, touch, assistive touch, and turn this on, and then if we add things like scroll down, this arrow was pointing the wrong way for some people, so now it's actually pointing down instead, and it should be fixed. There's other options you can set for that as well, but if you're using assistive touch, they have been working on it, and it should be working properly now for you. So hopefully that's resolved if you're having all sorts of issues. Now, there's some interesting code that's going on in the background. So let me give you a little example, then I can explain this a little bit better. When you're moving and your phone is physically moving with you in a car, for example, Apple is actually collecting data anonymously and sending that back to try and figure out traffic in your area if you use the Maps application. Google Maps does similar things. So what it's doing is seeing if you're going and then stopping and getting that information and seeing if there's traffic, and it helps with routing when you're trying to get somewhere. So when you know that you have busy streets and things like that, that's how it does it. Well, aside from sending just information about stopping and going and location, it's now sending barometric and indoor pressure anonymously and encrypted when you're moving. So what they're using that for specifically, I don't know if it's for weather, but they're sending barometric pressure since the phones actually have a sensor inside of them for barometric pressure. So it's just something new that's been mentioned in the codes. And then also, people that were having issue with mail is now working properly. In fact, they've fixed a few things. So for example, if you were selecting all mails in any folder and clicking delete, so if I go into mail, in email, when you go to edit and then you select all, and if you want to trash all of those email, it will now work properly. Also, one thing they've fixed in mail is if you long press on an email and you want to forward that email, it will now work properly and not crash the app. So those things should be fixed. Now, aside from that, there's not anything really physically new that I've been able to find that you can see. There may be slight tweaks to icons, but I haven't really seen anything. But as far as battery life, that's going to take a few days to measure. So in fact, I've been using iOS 13.2.2, and on 13.3 beta 1, it was okay. But battery life in general has been okay for me. This phone has 100% battery health since it's so new, and over the last 6 days, it's been fine on the previous version of the public release. I was getting about 10 to 12 hours of screen on time, but with the betas, it's going to take a few days to know. And of course, I'll do a follow-up if you'd like me to talk about that and other issues people may be having. Now, as far as performance is concerned, well, I've only been using this for about an hour and a half, depending on the device. Performance on these have been okay. I actually loaded Minecraft on not only the SE, but also the 6S Plus. So if I load it here in the background, it's not resuming. It has to reload, but RAM management hasn't seemed to be an issue for me. But you'll see these are loading and they're about the same as they've been before. If we go to play and go to My World, they're loading as you would expect. There's no performance differences really from the previous version that I've seen whatsoever, at least in trying this initially anyway. And the iPhone SE loaded quicker. Usually I have to close the app. It doesn't like to resume on some of these phones for some reason, but it's working fine on the SE. And then as far as changes to the iPad, there's absolutely nothing different. So performance on them is okay. When I was installing a bunch of apps, I thought performance wasn't great, but after I had those apps installed, performance is fine on an iPad Air 2. So it's not amazing, but it's still smooth and scrolling is fine. And then opening different applications is okay too, or going to Safari, for example, seems to be fine. So it's loading like I would expect. It works like you would expect for an iPad, but there's no new features. So don't expect anything exciting there for a while, and maybe we'll see some things in the future. I took a screenshot of storage before I installed the update and then after. So let's take a look at the storage. If we go to General and then iPhone storage, I'll wait for it to load. You'll see I'm using 56.8 gigabytes of 256 gigabytes. Let's take a look at what it was doing before. System actually will change based on what's going on, but you'll see system is 6.44 gigabytes. Other is 23.3. It wouldn't load for me before, but let's take a look. You'll see system was the same at 6.44. So I wouldn't expect really any differences as far as the storage is concerned. And overall, I would expect it to be about the same, and it may change over time though. Now let's take a look at the benchmarks for those of you that are interested in seeing that. I ran the benchmarks in Geekbench 5, so make sure you're on the latest version or these numbers will look very low unless you're on Geekbench 5. So they changed everything around. And you'll see the single core. Now I did run this right after I installed it, so these may be a little bit lower than normal, but the single core was 1,323, whereas the multi-core was 3,306. Now if we take a look at the history, it's not great, to be honest. It's better than it was when I installed 13.2.2, but in general, it's not amazing. It's not horrible. It's right about what you would expect. So I got as low as 3,061 after installing 13.2.2, and it's gone up since then. But let me lay out all of these different phones in the iPad so that we can take a look at all of them, and then you can compare them if you'd like to do that. Now on the left, we have the iPad Air 2, then we have the iPhone SE, then the iPhone 6S Plus, and then the iPhone 11 Pro Max. So this should give you an idea of the overall benchmarks for all of these devices and help you compare with what you've already got. And that's it for iOS 13.3 beta 2. Let me know what you think in the comments below, and I would expect another beta either next week, maybe a final before the end of the month. We don't really know. And then we're looking for that new 16-inch MacBook Pro to release as well. We may see that tomorrow, but we're not really sure at this point. But let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you found anything else, I'd love to have you list it there as well. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description as I always do. If you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.